the Lord. Dearly beloved sisters and brothers, once again, Father is here greeting you all. In the name of Jesus, we are on 278th day of our Bible pilgrimage. We are on Isaiah chapter 61, 62 and 63. Also, Sirach chapter 16 and Matthew chapter 18. Isaiah chapter 61 mainly has two sections. Verses 1 to 3 is a redeemer from God. Textual meaning should be this, that the prophet is speaking about himself. His mission is explained, what all things he was supposed to do. But the spiritual meaning, the fuller meaning, as we know without any doubt, in Luke chapter 4 verses 17 to 22, it's all about Jesus. As he testified in the synagogue of Nazareth that this text, this prophecy is fulfilled in me today, he said. Hallelujah. So it's the mission statement of Jesus, but the people of Jesus' time could not understand it. Hallelujah. Coming to chapter 62 of the book of Isaiah, it is another beautiful messianic prophecy. I think we should go through it a little. So verse 1, for Zion's sake I will not keep silent, and for Jerusalem's sake I will not rest until her vindication goes forth as brightness and her salvation as a burning torch. The Lord says, I will be restless. I will not rest until... So see, the Lord expresses his determination to make Jerusalem a lighthouse for the world. Here Zion is symbolic of the church of our Lord. So the plan from the foundation of the earth was for Jesus to offer his body to pay the penalty for sin for all mankind. So until he does that, he will be restless. Hallelujah. The second verse says, you shall be called by a new name. See, Revelation 2:17 speaks exactly that. God will give a new name. Then the third words, you shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. So Jesus will be proud of these that belong to him. He will present his church to the world as a precious crown or a precious stone. Then verse 4 says, you shall no more be termed forsaken. Your land shall no more be termed desolate, but you shall be called, my delight is in her. Your land will be called married. So my delight is in her. In Hebrew, it is called Hephzibah. Then your land is married. That is Beulah. These two verses, will make us believe that he's speaking about the bride of Christ. God's people will no longer be scorned. They are his. So the bride of Christ is spoken of in the same manner as a new Jerusalem. Hallelujah. Then verse 5, as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride. See, we are told that Jesus is coming back for a chaste virgin bride. So this just means that they have been spiritually faithful to him. We read in 2 Corinthians chapter 11 verse 2, St. Paul writes, I feel a divine jealousy for you, for I betrothed you to Christ to present you as a pure bride to her one husband. So exactly the same meaning here. Say hallelujah. Then words 6 and 7. It's beautiful. Upon your walls, O Jerusalem, I have set watchmen. All the day and all the night they shall never be silent. You who put the Lord in remembrance, take no rest and give him no rest until he establishes Jerusalem and makes it praise in earth. This is the greatest ministry in the church. See, the watchmen are the prayer warriors. So this watchmen are appointed in the church. That means the intercessors. It's all speaking, is spoken about the ministry of intercession, who constantly pray, giving God no rest until God's people and his city are restored. Hallelujah. So a threefold meaning we can find here. The Lord himself does not rest with regard to his church. He doesn't rest. And the second thing, he doesn't want his chosen people to keep silence in their prayer for church and the world. they should constantly pray and intercede. And the third thing is, he doesn't want his people to leave him alone concerning the salvation of souls. He wants that his people to be partakers in the ministry of saving souls. And for that, he wants this ministry of intercession to be taken seriously. Hallelujah. Verse 8 is like this. The Lord has sworn by his right hand and by his mighty arm. So Jesus is the right hand of God, and the blessings God has provided through Jesus for his own will not be stolen by the enemy. Then verse 9, but those who garner it shall eat it and praise the Lord, and those who gather it shall drink it in the courts of my sanctuary. See, Lord will give them to eat and drink in his sanctuary. What is it other than the Eucharist itself? Hallelujah. And verse 10, go through the gates, prepare the way for the people, build up the highway, clear it of the stone, lift up an ensign over the people. You know, the spiritual meaning could be, you know, it could be spoken of about the Christian who are headed for their promised land, that is heaven. So they should clear the way for those coming behind. They should not be an instrument of block or sin for other people. So that is, their standard of living should be so above any reproach that it would lead others to Christ. They should be instrument of blessing for other people. That is the meaning. Verse 11, behold, Lord has proclaimed to the end of the earth, say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your salvation comes. See, the daughter of Zion is most assuredly speaking of the Christians, the church. See, Isaiah is stressing one more time that Messiah is coming to save his people from their sins. So he is salvation for all mankind. Jesus is salvation for the entire mankind. And the last words, and they shall be called the holy people, the redeemed of the Lord, and you shall be called sought out, a city not forsaken. Jesus paid the price for sin on the cross with his precious blood. Hallelujah. So he has promised that he will never leave us. He will never forsake us. And we are never forsaken. We are children of God. We belong to him. We are his family. That is a beautiful chapter, full of messianic meaning. Jesus and his church is clearly seen in this chapter, chapter 62 of Isaiah. Praise the Lord. Chapter 63 of Isaiah mainly has two parts, verses 1 to 6. The main message is punishment or judgment proclaimed against Edom. Edom stands for the enemy of God or enemies of Israel. And here, God is depicted as someone who is coming from Edom after punishing them. That is why in crimson garments from Bosra. So that means his dresses are full of blood. Here, Bosra is the capital city of Edom. And the word meaning in Hebrew, Bosra, means grape gathering. So Isaiah developed a detailed comparison between treading grapes and shedding or pouring out blood. That's the meaning. Hallelujah. The second passage, second section is 7 to 19. It's a beautiful prayer. It's a prayer of repentance, like any penitential psalm. So the people who returned from captivity of Babylon, now they are making this prayer, meditating on all that God has done for them in the past. That's a beautiful moment of grace. And this prayer is really beautiful when we read. Hallelujah. Coming to chapter 16 of Book of Sirach, this chapter also has two parts. Verses 1 to 23 is the first part. It is dealing about the punishments proclaimed for sins. Mainly 9 messages here. The first message is godless children, ungodly children will bring distress. Hallelujah. Second message is lawless men will bring a disaster into their city, into their tribe. That is from verse 4. Then verse 6 we read, disobedience will bring wrath of God. Disobedient people will bring wrath of God. That is the third thing. Fourth thing is from verse 7, trusting in one's own might will bring punishment. your own strength if you. And the fifth message is from verse 8, insolence and pride will bring disaster. Hallelujah. Then the sixth message is from verse 10, rebellion and stubbornness will destroy people, even if in great number. You are in big number also, but it will bring distress and destruction. Then seventh message is from verse 11. A person who is stiff-necked will never go unpunished. Then eighth message is from verse 13. Sinful money will not allow the person to escape. Hallelujah. Then the last message, ninth message is from 17 to 23. That is, you cannot hide your sins from the Lord. No one should hide the sins. These are the messages from this chapter. Then the second part is verses 24 to 30. That's about the creation of the world. And the Lord has brought a beautiful order into the world. That is the main message. There is an order. According to an order only, everything works. Hallelujah. Coming to chapter 18 of Gospel of Matthew, it begins like this. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus saying, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? What is the background of this question? Theophylact of Ohrid, he writes, when they saw that Peter had been honored by Christ, for he had been honored by being instructed to give the coin for Christ and for himself. That was the last thing in the last chapter. So they fell prey to a human weakness and were stung by jealousy. So they approached and asked the Lord craftily, who is the greatest? That is the background. Then verse 5, whoever receives one such child in my name receives me. See, about this Epiphanius, the Latin, he says here, the Lord not only repressed the apostles' thoughts, but also checked the ambition of believers throughout the whole world so that he might be great who wanted to be least. For with this purpose, Jesus used the example of the child, that what he had been through his nature, we through our holy living might become. First, innocent. Like children, innocent of every sin. For a child does not know how to hold resentment or to grow angry. He does not know how to repay evil for evil. He does not think base thoughts. He does not commit adultery or arson or murder. He is utterly ignorant of theft or brawling or all things that will draw him to sin. He does not know how to disparage, how to blaspheme, how to hurt, how to lie. He believes what he hears. And what he is ordered, he does not analyze. He loves his parents in full affection. Therefore, what children are in their simplicity, let us become through a holy way of life as children innocent of sin. And quite rightly, one who has become a child innocent of sin in this way is greater in the kingdom of heaven. And whoever receives such a person will receive Christ. Hallelujah. Then verses 6 to or 9 is a temptation to sin, where the Lord says it would be better for him to have a great millstone fastened round his neck and be drowned in the depth of sea. About this, St. Augustine says, that is, it were better for him that desire of the things of the world, to which the blind and foolish are tied down, should sink him by its Lord to destruction. Then in verse 8, we read, therefore, if your hand or your foot offend you, cut them off and cast them from you. It is better for you to enter into life lame or maimed. So what is the meaning of this? About this, George Leo Haydock writes like this. And if thy hand or thy foot, these comparisons are to make us sensible that we must quit and renounce what is most dear to us. What is most dear to us sooner than remain in the occasion of offending God. Then again he says, these words more properly mean our relatives and friends who are united to us as closely as the different members of the body. This he had touched upon before, yet he again repeats it, for nothing is so pernicious, nothing so dangerous as the company and conversation of the dissolute. Connections of friendship and affinity are sometimes more powerful in inclining us to good or evil than open compulsion. On this account, Christ with great earnestness commands us to cut with those most near and dear to us when they are to us the immediate occasions of scandal. If they are becoming instrument of sin, you have to cut. That is what word of God says. Hallelujah. Then in verse 18, verse 10, see that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I tell you that in heaven their angels always behold the face of my Father who is in heaven. By little ones, he means those imperfect in their knowledge, or those recently baptized, or anyone who was forced out of the church for wickedness. Theodore the Stratelets, he wrote like this. Little ones means not about children, but about imperfect in knowledge, and those who are away from the church, or those who are newly baptized, and so on. Here, their angels, what is means, you know, the Jews also believed that men had their own good angels, or angels appointed to be their guardians. Hallelujah. See, they have angels constantly pleading their cause in the divine presence. They are now weak and unable to defend themselves, but they have their advocates in heaven, accusing those who offer them any injury or scandal. It is evident from many parts of scripture that angels are appointed guardians of kingdoms, countries, cities, and even individuals. Hallelujah. The angel of the Lord shall encamp round them, that we have seen. So Saint Jerome does not hesitate to affirm that every man has an angel assigned him at his birth, which he confirms from chapter 12 of Acts, where it is related that the girl thought she saw Peter's angel. Then Saint Augustine says, I esteem it, O my God, an inestimable benefit that thou hast granted me an angel to guide me from the moment of my birth to my death. Hallelujah. So that is Saint Augustine saying. So we all have an angel to take care of us. That's the beautiful thing. And our love for our guardian angel also should increase. May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.